我来念一下第一个问题：对于曾经有过比较重大过犯的领袖，他们是否仍是可信任的？是否可以重建他们后，鼓励他们继续做领袖？ OK, please.
There's really two questions there.
这里有两个问题。
The first question is, if the leader has committed offense, serious offenses, is he still trustworthy?
第一个问题是，如果有领袖曾经犯过比较大的过犯，他们是否还可以被信任？
And the simple answer is no.
很简单的回答就是不可以了。
That doesn't mean that trust cannot be rebuilt.
但这不表示说他们的信任是不可以重新被建立起来。
But when a serious offense has been committed, trust has been broken.
但因为他们之前犯过太重大的过犯，所以这个信任已经被破坏了。
And repairing trust is directly proportional to the seriousness of the offense.
那这个信任度的修复跟他们所犯过错的严重程度是成正比。
The more serious the offense, the longer and harder it is to rebuild trust.
也就是说，他们犯的错误越大，那么修复他们这个信任度的时间就会越久，也会越困难。
So when a leader commits a serious offense, he's not trustworthy.
所以领袖如果犯了很大的过犯，那他们是不能够再可信任。
But now that now brings us to the second question.
这就带我们来到第二个问题。
Is it possible to rebuild this person?
可不可能重建这个人呢？
I think the biblical answer is yes.
那符合圣经的回答，我相信是的，肯定回答。
The amount of time and difficulty are directly proportional to the seriousness of the offense.
修补他们这个时间和重建他们这个人的需要的时间和难度是跟他们所犯的错的严重程度成正比的。
So leaders who commit serious offenses and demand to be trusted are not taking a biblical attitude.
所以如果一个领袖他犯了严重的错误，而他要求人们再去信任他，那是不符合圣经的。
Trust is not something you demand.
信任不是你可以去要求别人做的。
Trust is something others grant to you.
信任是别人给予你的。
You can't demand it from them.
你没有办法要求别人去信任你。
You have to earn it.
你必须要自己获得别人。
And it takes time and effort.
而且需要很大的努力，需要很长时间。
I think one passage of scripture that relates to this is Galatians chapter 6, verse 1.
比如说加拉太书的六章一节。
If a leader is overtaken in a fault, you who are
going,
yeah.
如果有人偶然被过犯所胜
，You who are spiritual should restore such a one.
你们属灵的人就应当把他挽回。
If we should restore them, that presumes that we could restore them.
如果圣经说你们应当挽回他，那么背后的潜台词是我们可以挽回他的。
So it implies that trust has been broken.
这就暗示了这个人的信任度已经被破坏了。
And it implies that trust has to be rebuilt.
也暗示着这种信任度是需要被重新建立起来的。
And I would say again that the length of time and the amount of difficulty to rebuild trust is proportional to the seriousness of the offense.
可是我还是要再强调一次，那就是这种重建信任度的时间和困难的程度跟他们犯错的严重程度是成正比的。
Humility is a signal of a person's willingness to submit to rebuilding.
那一个人他是不是愿意来顺服，来得到重建，一个很大的标志就是他是否谦卑。
Demanding to be trusted is a signal that a person is not worthy to be trusted.
假如这个人他要求别人去再次信任他，那就标志着这个人不配别人去信任他。
Perhaps we should take the next question.
Okay, 下一个问题。
You want to read it?
问题啊，好的，我来读一下。有没有调查研究显示，导致属灵领袖无法坚持到底的前三个因素是什么？能坚持服侍到底的前几个因素又是什么？ Okay, please.
Yeah, I think we've already talked about that in the lecture. I mentioned those three sources, and they consistently point to the fact that the top three factors causing spiritual leaders to fail to persevere would be lack of success, loneliness, and committing sins, personal sin. Yeah, those are the three big things.
我们刚才在讲座里已经提到过了，根据那三个研究，就发现领袖失败的三个前面的最大因素，一个是事业的不成功，第二个是孤单感，第三个就是犯了个人的罪。
And I think the answer to the second question is really the subject of the lecture, so I think we can move on to the next question.
那至于能坚持服侍到底的前几个因素，就是我们今天晚上讲座的主要内容，所以我们看下一个问题。领袖要持怎样的心智，或者做到哪些方面才算是忠心？
So the third question then.
Yes, please.
And you've already read that question?
I have already read it, yes.
Okay. Again, this question could take a long time to answer.
要仔细回答这个问题需要很多时间。
But I think maybe the simple thing to say is that the primary qualification would be an attitude of stewardship.
最简单的一个回答就是最重要的一个素质就是做管家的管理的态度。
We talk about this a lot in the course.
我们在课程当中在这个问题上说得很详细。
One of the primary biblical metaphors for leadership is stewardship.
在圣经里面讲到做领袖用的最多的最重要的一个隐喻就是管家。
And the emphasis here is the one whom I am serving.
那个隐喻里面最强调的就是你做管家所服侍的是谁。
If I think I'm serving the people of my church,I may not be able to persevere very well.
假如我以为我所服侍的是教会的会众，那么我很可能没法坚持到底。
But if I know I'm called to serve the Lord and not merely the people, then that might help me to persevere.
但假如我知道我所受的呼召是要去侍奉主他自己，而不仅仅是会众，那么我才有可能坚持到底。
The one to whom I am ultimately responsible is the Lord.
我最终要向他交账的是主。
And the one who ultimately will decide whether I have been successful is the Lord.
而最终决定我是否成功了的也是主。
Of course, I serve the Lord's people.
当然，我也服侍神的子民。
But above all, I'm a steward.
但最重要的，超越一切的，就是我是管家。
I serve the Lord.
我所服侍的是我的主。
So the mindset of a persevering leader is to recognize that they're a servant of the Lord.
所以做一个领袖要持的心智最重要的就是要明白我是服侍主。
They will give an account to him for their faithfulness.
我是否忠心，最后要交账的对象是主。
Okay. Next.
下一个问题。Okay, I'll read it first. 第四个问题是在服侍受挫时，如何仍然保持热情与信心？ Okay.
Again, I think to some extent I addressed this question in the lecture.
我在刚才的讲座里已经部分回答了这个问题。
I would just refer back to the question of, you remember the slide about confidence.
刚才我讲过关于确信的那个因素。
And I mentioned two things, the confidence that, in the resurrection, that Jesus has already won the victory.
我提到说，因为主耶稣复活了，表示他已经得胜了。
So yes,I'm operating in a context of spiritual warfare, but I'm also operating in the context of Jesus' victory.
所以我现在做领袖是在一个属灵征战的背景里，但同时也是在一个得胜的背景底下。
As the book of Revelation reminds us, Jesus is winning.
这就是启示录告诉我们的，耶稣正在得胜。
Jesus is worthy.
耶稣是值得的，是配得的。
Jesus is watching.
耶稣正在观看。
Jesus is working out his plan.
耶稣正在成就，实施他的计划。
In the end, this is not my ministry.
归根到底，这不是我的侍奉。
In the end, this is Jesus' work.
这是耶稣的工作。
And he has won.
而他已经得胜了。
I can persevere because Jesus has won.
我能够坚持到底，是因为耶稣得胜了。
Okay, next question.
好，下一个问题。Okay, I'll read it first. 作为教会牧者，找事工领导者。作为教会牧者或事工领导者，如何面对和处理长期服侍中内心的失落与孤独感？ Okay. Yes, please.
Again, you remember in the lecture I mentioned the importance of having being intentional about companionship in ministry.
我讲座的时候已经讲过，很重要的是我们要有意的去培养同工。
So the first answer I would give to that question is anticipate loss and loneliness and therefore build partnerships and friendships and community in ministry.
所以我第一个对这个问题的回应就是你要心里有一个预期，知道你有的时候会失落，有的时候会孤单，所以你必须要积极的去培养合作者，要培养朋友，有友谊，而且要有一个群体。
As much as possible, do not allow yourself to become isolated.
尽可能的不要让自己变得孤立。
Cultivate partners in ministry.
一定要有意的培养同工合作。
And then I would also add, take comfort in the scriptures.
另外我还要补充说，你要从圣经当中找到安慰。
Notice how many of the Psalms are laments about loss and loneliness.
你有没有注意到诗篇当中有多少篇幅是在悲叹一个人的孤单和他的失落？
Use the Psalms to pour out your heart to God.
所以你要善用诗篇来向主倾心吐意。
Recognize that saints have been feeling loss and loneliness for centuries.
你要明白，众圣徒其实几百年以来都是常常会感觉到孤单和失落的。
They didn't deny it.
他们没有否认这一点。
They didn't cover it up.
他们也没有掩饰这一点。
They didn't say, I'm not really lonely.
他没有说我没有孤单啊。
They told God and themselves the truth.
他们对神对自己都是说了实话的。
And they poured out their hearts to God.
而他们对神倾心吐意。
And as they did so, God brought them comfort and assurance.
当他们这样做的时候，神就给他们安慰，给他们确信。
And you can find that comfort and assurance when you go to the Psalms as well.
所以你也一样，你也可以到诗篇里面去寻找神的安慰和给你的确定。
Okay, next question.
下一个问题。Okay, I read it first. 作为教会领袖的妻子，可以怎样帮助丈夫坚持到底呢？尤其是丈夫在受到挫折或怀疑呼召的时候。Yes, please.
I wish my wife were here to answer that question.
我真希望我的太太在这儿可以来回答这个问题。
I think, again, I would just remind you, if you're the wife of a church leader and you find that your husband doesn't have a network of companions in ministry, that you should urge them to develop that.
假如你的先生是一位牧师，而你发现他身边没有一群同工跟他一起合作的，那你应该强烈的要求教会要培养这样一个团队。
We would say ministry is a team sport.
因为服事实在是一个团队运动，集体运动。
You're not meant to conduct ministry alone.
你本来就不应该一个人单打独斗。
And of course, that means first that the wife of a leader should be a true partner.
那这就意味着，首先一点，妻子应该是丈夫的一个真实的合作者。
So if the wife's attitude is, well, that ministry, that's the husband's job. That's not, I don't have anything to do with that.
所以如果作为牧师的妻子，如果你的态度是说那是他的侍奉，那是他的事情，跟我没关系。
Don't be surprised if that's a cause of loneliness and discouragement.
那你的丈夫如果在侍奉当中觉得很灰心，很孤单，就一点都不奇怪了。
You need to let your husband know that you're a real partner in his ministry.
你应该让你的丈夫知道你是跟他合作的，你是他的最真诚的同工。
But you also need to encourage him to carry out his ministry with other partners.
那另外方面，你也应该鼓励你的丈夫要跟其他人一起来服侍。
And not allow him to become isolated.
不要允许他变得越来越孤立。